Can we have a wall-mounted chessboard? Or this kind of a spatula which is standing in the span and almost looks like a bird popping up. Or a peeler which almost replicates your hand actions. Or a packaging which feels like it's a natural extract of hand. And we need to get into users' shoes, so we need to be empathetic about it. Many times on the airport which we see these kind of signs, and these are the signs which everyone has observed that there are wayfinding signs, but some designer has thought that how to make it more user-friendly, and he has incorporated a small icon, very user-friendly feature, saying that you need to walk up to 6 minutes. So there are different signs, but you need to know that where you are going and how long it will take, so you can plan your journey if you are taking a halt there. A small feature, but very empathetic. And in the end, we are integrator, because as I said earlier, designer is like a juggler. So we need to integrate technology, business, and design. So this was a kind of a cupboard which has got a steamer into it, designed by Samsung. It's called as air dresser. So rather than a washing machine, many times we don't use complete washing machine. So how about I'm going for a party and I need just one of my blazer to be steam clean, not even washed. So this come out of those needs, and which where integrates, or something like a baby cradle designed by Fuse Project, which has got very complex mechanisms, but it has for the babies, which for them to easy to sleep. It has got camera and it works on the app also. And ultimately, user is the king. So there are different kinds of users, and some of them are really innocent, some of them are genuine, some of them are helpless, kind-hearted, some of them are like gubber. So all this kind of user you need to tackle with. So you can't say that you need to always talk to millennials. And because India is a land of contrast, so we need to tackle where there is a jaguar pulled up by the bullock cart. And that's why a designer sees users advocate. So engineer will talk from his side, marketing will talk from his side, but who is going to talk from designer's side or a user's side? So we are the advocate of users. And all these things, where it's a flat pack furniture by IKEA, or a robotic vacuum cleaner, which goes, especially in India, where the maid is a big issue. All these products actually talks from the user's side. A refrigerator which was designed, which is a bottom-mount freezer. Many times people don't use refrigerator fulless. So for freezer to the full. So that's why freezer has been shifted to the bottom. Or a Samsung washing machine, which has, in India, many people do a hand wash. They prefer a hand wash for the collar. So they have given a top tray which you can scrub on it. We all know water is a big problem, and in full part, designer may not be able to solve the issue completely. But some designer has designed this shower, which has got a LED strip into it, and based on your it is a kind of quite a hi-fi shower. Based on your it works with the Alexa and the for your phone app control. If you set the water limit, let's say 15 liter, based on that it will change the color as you are exceeding. So you will get a visual feedback that you are exceeding the water, and it will just make you conscious. So we are not just solving the complete world's water scarcity problem, but in our bits and pieces we are making user conscious, and by bringing it very experientially. Nobody loves MRI machines and MRI rooms, but when Philips designed these rooms, they thought of the users. So every room has got these projections, and they get changed based on the age group. So kids' room will have a very nice aquatic themes. So he will enjoy the MRI. So it's a quite a nauseating and very high tensed feeling in an MRI room. But by changing this, you actually make users at ease. And this I got a few days back on a WhatsApp, and I felt that it's quite relevant in today's time. On one side, there is accessibility when you are dealing with either products or a mobile app. But sometimes, as a designer, we get so overwhelmed that we would like to have user experience on top of it. We want to build some aesthetics into it. There is a user interface. And by doing all these things, sometimes we forget what is the real need of the user. And that's why that user, if you see accessibility, is just drowning down there. And it is very important, that's why, to balance between what is feasible, what is viable, and what is desirable between design, business, and technology. And that's what the real essence of design thinking is. Some of the work I will just show when what we have, the Tata Elxsi has done in the field. So these are some of the case studies I will just quickly run through. We designed the complete Kochi Metro service design. It's a complete experience design part of it. We received iF Design Award for this. We designed all the touch points of Kochi Metro. Some of you who, if you have traveled through it, we designed wayfinding signages, mobile app, the ticketing system, ticketing counters, the train livery, branding, station design. Everything has been done by Tata Elxsi. The other product, air cooler, has been designed by Tata Elxsi part. I'm not the part of that team. I'm not the part of that team which worked on this right now. But we designed this air cooler, which won the Best Design Award in 2019. So beauty of this design is the top part of the cooler remains same. Just by changing the bottom tank, you get a three variant. So it comes in 55 liter, 40 liter, and 26 liter. But the top part remains same, so the mold investment is very remain constant for the three variant. Only the top tank investment changes. So that's why the business is very important while you are designing. It becomes very viable for the businesses. This is how it looks like. It's quite Wi-Fi air cooler. It comes with a IoT enabled feature. There are two variants, digital control panel as well as the knob. The other product which we worked and which we got award for India's Best Design Award is this jerry can for the oil. Very simple feature. Jerry can existed since ages, but it's very difficult to lift when the jerry can is filled. So what we have tried to given is a small knob at a half level, so you can use your normal can through the knob, and once it goes below that knob, you can easily lift it because by that time the weight is less than 2.5 liters. We did some innovation in the cap also so that it's easy and no spill cap. Design and technology goes hand in hand. So this is one of the project we got Best Design Award, which is there's a company called Wellspun, who is one of the largest rug makers who design. Introduces carpets, and they come up with a very interesting and challenge to us. They're saying that the rugs has become very monotonous and rudimentary product. How can we make it more experiential and immersive? So Tata Elxsi designed these rugs, and we designed a augmented reality app for it. So it is becoming storytelling rug rather than just a normal rug. So we did lots of consumer research. We created storyboards. Tata Elxsi's other branch called VCL, Visual Computing Labs, they have designed the stories out of it. And user has to select the story, and once you scan the tablet to the rug, it will play that story. So it becomes very immersive. I'll just play a small video for that.
Sir, sound is off, sir.
Sorry, sound is not coming. Sound is not there.
It's not coming. It's not.
Yeah, it's not coming. Yes.
Just a minute. Let me just play it again.
Yes, now it's okay.
Yeah, so that was from the augmented reality. Tata Elxsi has designed HMI design for the, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, very well,
okay.
Yes.
Sorry. Yeah. So Tata Elxsi has designed the HMI for the Tata Nexon, and it's an Android Auto based on that. It has got a lot of cool features, voice command, and compatible with the Apple CarPlay. Floating dashboard for the infotainment, as well as there's a IC panel. So these are some of the screens for that. So automotive HMI design is quite a challenging field. So because you need to reduce the clutter, and there has to be very less cognitive load on the user because he's driving, and it's a quite tensed operation. That was from the automotive, but from the industrial side also, product designers has a lot of challenges. So we designed this robot for the Tata TAL Bravo, which is Tata Automation Limited. So it was at that time, it was India's first industrial robo. Very challenging because, as I said, we need to balance with the technology and the manufacturing. So this was a classic example. That's why I thought to include it. So how you get aesthetics into the something which is so machine related and something so automated. So it's a quite a challenging task to get aesthetics into it because it is highly functional product. And we designed complete range for the robo family, right from 2 kg to 30 kg. So it's a perfect example of balancing between technology and the aesthetics. Very limited aesthetics, but yes, it still has got a lot of power and the premiumness into it. Complete language has to look like right for across the robots. So we designed the visual language for that, having the features and the curves which are matching with the each and every product, so that semantics and the aesthetics goes hand in hand. We recently received this IF award for this is designed by Tata Elxsi London team. So it's a wearable device for the specially abled people who are like autism and Alzheimer's. So it works on the audio feedback. So it's an innovative solution which is very less intrusive. So many users, those who are facing autism and Alzheimer's, when they're dealing day to day life situations, this device actually gives you audible feedback. It has got its own camera inbuilt into it, and it helps to people recognize a person. So through the camera, and sometimes Alzheimer's disease people, they forget the names. So this camera will detect the face and prompt them what is the name of that person. Very nicely designed product and very helpful for those kind of people. And Shobhik has strictly given me the time, so I'm just sticking it with that. So here I'm coming to the end of my presentation where I love this quote, which says that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So in a way, we are product designers, are magicians, and we need to create magic from the keeping our legs on all the three stones like design, technology, and business. And then only we can call it as a completely experiential solution. Thank you. As Hari said, that you may include one slide. So I have a Matchbox collection, and I have a page called the Matchbox Story on Facebook as well as on Insta, where I keep writing about the matchboxes from all over the world. It's a good rich source of graphic design as well as product design. So you guys maybe sometime do like, share, follow, criticize, all up to you. Thank you. That's it from my side, Harry.
Yes, yes. It's a very nice presentation, very interesting. So I open the question and answer session to everyone. Sure. But first, I would like to ask you a question.
Sure.
LXE happens to be one of the largest studios in India, you know, as a design studio, because it is also tied up with the corporate Tata, you know.
Yeah.
So the projects, the nature of projects is big, and the decision making is also relatively bolder than other studios, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A couple of examples I thought was the Jerry Can.
Mm-hmm.
The Jerry Can, that idea has gone into market, correct?
Yes.
With the tap. Now, if that would happen with a regular studio, I'm not very sure how how the company would be confident to how the client would be confident to take such an idea into their design. But I think sometimes I think because it is Tata LXE also, that there is so much credibility and so much weight, you know, on the client side also, that they take such decisions. Do you think this is the case? Because you work with Elephant, then you worked with Samsung, and so how do you compare this scenario?
You are perfectly right, Hari, because one of the major reasons of whether benefit of or advantage of Tata LXE is it's a engineering and technology company too. So when we worked with, there is everything right from automation, medical appliances, branding, everything is under one shelter. So one point is definitely client gets a lot of confidence in you because it's a one point contact for all their needs. Second side, when we work with these kind of innovations, because of the technology team and the engineering team is quite strong, we can quickly try and we can quickly fail. So we can quickly fail and we can quickly succeed also.
Correct.
So because technology and engineering team is quite strong, they are quite experienced people. So most of the 50% of the work happens there. If you are experienced and if you are, because the hustle which is going to come in the future, they already envisage that. And they, so that the product development cycle reduces.
Correct.
And that gives an advantage to the client because it's saving a lot of money and the time.
Correct.
So you are right. Having a technology and engineering team in-house gives a lot of benefit to the design team. Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. Hello, sir.
If I may ask one more question,
Sure.
The number of industrial designers versus the number of graphic user experience and engineers in your LXE as a whole, as a, you know, you have several offices, right, in different parts.
Yeah.
So roughly, approximately, what would be the team size?
The industrial, just industrial designers, there will be around 25.
Okay.
So we have offices in London, Bangalore, Trivandrum, and Pune.
Pune.
So as a core industrial designers, there must be around 25 to 30 people. but the engineering team is slightly quite big.
Oh, is bigger, and user experience also there will be bigger, no? Graphics.
Yeah,
and...
user experience is also bigger. Graphics team is around again 25-30. User experience people are also quite a bit. Research also comes in between. So.
Okay. I'll leave it open to other people to ask questions.
Sure.
Yeah,
sure.
Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Hi.
This is Rishikesh again. So I actually have two questions, and one of them is related to Hari sir's first question. So, Tata Elxsi is the only design studio or consultancy which is publicly listed that I know of. So I was wondering now, because you've worked in design studios as well, like Elephant Design, how much does this affect the operation in a consultancy, because now you have shareholders for a company and like there are individual people who are investing in the company. So does that affect the operation in any way?
I may not be the right person to answer, but actually having a public listed is about the size and the revenue. So it definitely does affect the overall infrastructure. And once it affects the infrastructure and the resources, it affects your quality of design and the output too. So it goes hand in hand, I would say.
Okay. Oh, thank you. And so my second question is related to the Airtel Internet TV. I don't know if you've worked on it, but you might have come across people who've worked on it in the
company. I know the
team. It's one of the products that really interests me, because I really feel it was really smartly made, because you combine DTH with the internet TV in a very seamless manner. But considering the current like market, where you know a lot of people already have or own DTH boxes like Tata Sky or Dish TV, and newer customers, they generally go for Chromecast or buying a Amazon Fire Stick. I don't know if you know this, but if you could give any insight on why this product was given a go when the trend is going towards online streaming and OTT platforms.
Sorry, I did not work on that, and I joined. So, but I would say, I think as I recall, I think it's a slightly old product. It's not very latest product. It was designed maybe 2-3 years back, I guess so. And when this Netflix and Chromecast is about to pick up that. So when this was launched, this was quite a stir in the market, because it was combining the internet and the DTH connection. But post that, I think this craze has caught up. So when they launched it, I'm sure they must have had a good sizable market at that time, otherwise they will not make this mistake.
Right.
And still, even if I would say and it's a cyclic process, not only about talking about Airtel, it's a cyclic process. So even if there are two door refrigerator, people will not stop designing one door refrigerator, because today's one door refrigerator is going to buy tomorrow's two door refrigerator.
Right,
and
right.
There might be, so refrigerator one door market is, I would say, still 65% of the market. But okay. you cannot stop designing one door refrigerator, because it's a major market share. So similarly, even if people are buying Chromecast and the Fire Sticks, still the major market share is cable TV operators and Tata Sky and these kind of connections. So
right.
Today's Tata Sky connectors will be aspiring for the Chromecast or the video on demand VOD services.
Right.
So it's a cyclic process. So it completely depends on the market share.
Okay.
Yeah. We are basically, that's why I always say that we are, when we design, we should design for other 90%. So there is a term called other 90%. We comes in a 10% of the population actually. Whereas majority of the user and the majority of the world, it's still using very differently.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you for this insight. It's really helpful. Hello.
Hi.
Hi, yeah, this is Rishabh.
Yeah, Rishabh.
Yeah, I wanted to like a lot of your presentations, a lot of your products revolve around, you know, how studying the users and how users' problems were solved. So like I just wanted to know, like with the current pandemic situation, like a lot of companies are wondering what's going to happen post, you know, after the pandemic. How is user, I mean, how is the behavior going to change? What will they want? Or so like any sort of specific insights that you might have noticed because of this.
Yeah, interesting question. I was expecting this. Some of the there is going to be definitely change with respect to the how you are interacting with the product and the places. The experiences will be definitely key in this. Some of the trends which I feel is one trend is many of the people are going virtual. So virtual experiences and the technologies which give you that kind of experience like augmented reality, mixed reality, all these are going to be becoming more crucial and they will become more challenging. Second part is the things which you are not able to touch and feel. So the things which will be like companies like Magic Leap or some companies who are dealing with this kind of product where there is a haptic feedback to the user. So this touch and feel experience virtually is going to be key in the future.
Okay.
Other trend which I think is people are going to lose interactions. People will be more isolated, self-centered. How do you, again, once you go back to the work from the from work from home to the again work from office or work from actual places, dealing with these kind of people and the interactions will become again key, especially in the kids, because it will become even more important for them.
Right.
So that's one thing which I see. Third thing which I feel is wherever you will go now, you will be more than enjoying. If you go to mall, more than enjoying, you will be now worried about whether I will caught a COVID or not. You will be worried about whether the place is sanitized or not. So giving a confidence to the user or to the viewer or to the visitor that you are safe, it will become very crucial. Although you are taking all the measure, but user may not know whether you have sanitized this space or not. So how will he
Okay.
get that feedback? How will he get that feeling that I am safe in a theater or a mall? I don't know. I mean,
Interesting.
if you visit a mall next day and you don't know if you're touching a right kind of a chair or right kind of a handle, or if you're traveling in a lift, whether that lift is sanitized or not. So that feedback to the user is going to be key to your experiences.
Right.
Yeah, that's all I can see top of the mind.
Yeah, very, very interesting. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else?
Yes, sir, Prakash here again.
Yeah,
Sir, actually, you designed some HMI system for Nexon. So
Prakash.
I know that HMI is like some like beyond the product design, I guess. Except like there is a ton of things behind that screen. So I just want to know how it works, like how we design that connectivity, or like yeah, this things behind that screen, how we interact with that. And how we design that thing.
Yeah, so basically, I haven't worked on that project, so I'm not expert in that. But as I said, when you design with these kind of a digital screens also, the semantics, the cognitive load, the information overload becomes your key. So you may not actually the when you are driving, your whole attention to be at the driving side. But how you help user with the right kind of inputs? It's not about just the information layouting. It's about how do you get the right kind of information in that. So whether if it's some engine cautionary sign which you want to highlight, how it will get highlighted on the screen. If you want to play music controls, there is a combination of voice, gesture, and the touch. So how do you manage some of these are actually crucial because they're all based on the user feedback. So it's a combination of all these touch, feel, voice control, gesture control things. So it's a good combination of technology at the same time, manual controls, because you cannot go wrong. So any screen is like actually supporting screen. So even if the screen damages, even if the screen display goes off, the driver should not be misled. So you still need to be in control even if your screen goes off. So the control has to be always with the driver and it should not be completely depend on digital screen. So there are these kind of factors you need to consider while designing the HMIs.
Yeah, thanks.
Hello, sir. This is Mudit.
Yeah, Mudit.
So as you correctly pointed out, you know, the role of the designer is to, you know, switch and balance between, you know, the three stones, which are business, technology, and experience.
Yeah.
Technology, you know, and most of today's product designers, they come from engineering background. Experience is fine. So normally we are studying design.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get to learn about business throughout the, mm-hmm. you know, entire career? If we are not having any formal, you know, education of management or mm-hmm.
Yeah, a good question. Some of the points from the business side you will learn over the period of experience. Once you start dealing with the business or sales and marketing on this kind of commercial side people. So one side I will kept it open for the experience because nothing beats experience. Unless and until you take experience, you won't be able to get that. Other side, when you deal with the business, when you want to learn that, is nothing different than what we practice as a designer. So for example, if you say in business, the if you reduce the component cost, the overall product cost will be less. So we are talking about business. If you say that material cost can be saved, then you are talking about business. So just by component reduction, material saving, simplifying the experiences and the product, reducing the technological components and the complex linkages and the mechanisms, reducing the flashy part of it, not much glamorous part of it, anything which is minimal and which is functional, if you keep that, all these things, you are actually talking about business in a way.
Right.
By reducing the cost of the component, by reducing the parts itself, by reducing the much of the glossier part of the products or like graphics and the surface finish and all these things, more than functionality, if you reduce that, so it's like a skim milk, it's like slimming down all the parts and coming to the bare minimalism is actually talking about business. Because business, eventually, if you don't do that, user will give the feedback to the business that this is cost is increased and that's why, or this product is a very, imagine that if you have designed a product which has got a very nice fascia and a very good surface finish, and over the period of time that surface finish start peeling off and it start the colors start going off. Then business will get the feedback and user will give the feedback that this product is not good because the surface finish is getting damaged. Imagine that if as a product designer, you could have thought about it, that this is a cosmetic part, and I may reduce this cost in this by reducing the surface finish and giving a basic finish which is much more durable and reliable. Right. If you as a product designer could have thought about it, then user did not had a bad feedback about it.
Right. Exactly.
But as we haven't thought about it, user is having the feedback as this product is not good. The same thing business will give it to you, and business will next time tell you that we don't want such kind of flashy product.
All right.
So when we are design, we are actually design. Talking about business.
All right. So can we say, you know, generally it's not like designers have a say in, you know, in the business aspect of any product. So there are marketing teams and there are sales teams who, you know, collect data and all. So mm-hmm. all the numbers they collect and getting insights from those numbers, they kind of tell designers this is to be designed. So do designers have freedom, you know, to some extent?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Because why business is getting feedback? Because you haven't been to users after designed.
Right.
Imagine that if you created product, you tested it in the lab, you tested it in the user environment, and then you launched it.
Yes.
If you realize what is the insight, then user will not have a different opinion because you have already taken care of it. Yes. User is giving you feedback to the business because designer has not validated it after launch.
Yes, yes.
So it's a designer's onus that he need to test the product well. Second thing, he need to validate it. So your designer's role doesn't end just by designing. After launch, how the product is doing, you need to validate it.
Right, yeah.
So your role doesn't end actually, virtually.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Thank you so much for the answers.
Thanks.
Sir. My question might be a bit conflicting in nature, but my question would be, what are some of the areas where the small studios may have edges over big studios like yours? Like in mm-hmm. in all the aspects, let's say design point of view, business point of view, even the management point of view. So what are some of the areas where you feel that the small studios have an edge over the big ones?
Yeah, yes, good question. It's not at all conflicting because I'm coming from all this background. I worked with a small agency, I worked with global design centers, and I'm now working with the corporate design center. So not at all conflicting. Small studios, if you ask me, you get to learn a lot because there is a resource crunch. So you have to be really versatile in that, and you learn a lot of things. Because you need to make a model, you need to go and research, you need to create prototype, you need to 3D model it. So all things, maybe you will be the one man army for that. If you go to global design centers, you will get exposure to the lot of international design too, because you will be working with international design centers like Samsung. So there will be, you will be dealing with those aesthetics taste also from international market. Whereas corporate design centers or something design center, like large design centers like Tata Elxsi, you get to learn a lot about technology and business angle of it. So obviously you learn about how to integrate the technology and the business into your products. Whereas there are dedicated people for the prototyping and engineering, so your one-man army role slightly reduces, but your load on the business and the technology side increases because you are dealing with those people, so you need to understand what language they are talking. So you need to learn those angles, whereas you are pretty flexible with the prototyping and the engineering part of it, let's say. So there are dedicated teams to the work, yeah.
Yeah. So, even on an organization level, so what edges do the small studios have over the big ones? So like on an organization level.
Mm-hmm. Organization level means what? I didn't like, for example.
Let's say there are certain clients that the big companies wouldn't actually be interested in taking up the projects that these companies might not be interested in from a business point of view. Even however interesting those projects might be, but let's say the business point of view may be the one which would restrict the big studios. Also, let's say I feel that some clients may also get intimidated by the designs the big studios might be presenting, because on an organization level there are a lot of people working on those designs, and so they might actually feel that it's the company, the studio might not be that flexible when it comes to taking the opinions of the clients. In those terms, what do you feel?
As far as the global design centers like Samsung is concerned, there is no question of taking client. So they directly, we work for the Samsung or we work for the brand. Whereas other small agencies or the large agencies, many times this situation doesn't happen, because no matter how the small client is or the small or the big client is, it solely depend on the mutual agreement of and the capabilities. So if sometimes a small agency may not be able to cater the requirement of the what client is really needed, they may not be in a position to cater to that. But as far as the large design agencies like Tata Elxsi is concerned, if they are flexible and if they are they have the resources and the manpower to cater to the different requirement of the client, they are definitely willing. So it doesn't depend on the size of the budget. It solely depends on your capacity, your resource management, your competence towards working for that project. So it's completely based on that rather than actually budget.
Okay, thank you, sir. That was very helpful.
Thanks. Yeah.
Hello, sir. This is Rishikesh again.
Yes.
So my question is, because most of your projects are, you know, deployed in the US and Europe, like a major part of projects are done over there. Now, because research is such a big part of the design process, what all mediums do you use at Tata Elxsi to gather information and generate insights? Because you know, you just mentioned your team is like the industrial design team is of 25 to 30 designers, and then catering to such a huge market that too, which is not in India, how does the research go about?
Research, you mean India research or international research?
International research.
Okay. So as I said, we do have some of the international offices. One office is design office is in studio is in London. If the research is mostly concentrated there, then no worry. If the research is anywhere in the world, there are different methodologies which. So sometimes for the recruitment, which there are recruiting agencies. So we recruit, they help you to recruit the people. So we design the questionnaire, we design the recruiting guide. That what kind of people the recruiters we want. So what kind of users we want? Are they middle class, higher class, lower class? What kind of appliances they own? From which part of the family they are coming? Whether they are joint family, nuclear family? What should be the income level? What is their learning level? So all these parameters we set it and then we give it to recruitment agency to recruit for us. So they recruit those kind of users which fit to our criteria. So that is for the recruitment. So we do direct interviews, we do our digital diary, we do empathy mapping, card sorting. Now because of the pandemic, we are doing online research, online video research. So there are different tools and techniques based on the project which we do.
Okay.
Yeah, but the boundary doesn't matter actually. Once we do recruitment, then our designers and the researchers travel. We do research together if there are direct interviews. There are ethnographic research where we do a lot of photo shoot and scenario mapping, contextual environment photo shoot.
Okay. But yeah. Are there any culture shocks which you face when you look at a certain context, a certain region and when you look at the data from that region and you're looking at the data from some other region, have you been in any situation where there's a big culture shock? Okay, why is this, why do people over here prefer something over something else? Do you have any story related to that?
Yeah, definitely, because every country or every culture is so different. I mean, so I myself traveled to China once for the automotive research, and this was before COVID, don't worry, 2018 end. So I myself traveled to China for the automotive interior and the features research, and I realized there is so huge difference in terms of technology as well as in terms of the kind of affordance power which Chinese consumers has. So, and the kind of so in China there are, I felt that the interior people are more so going for the SUVs because their infrastructure is quite huge. So SUV, I mean SUV like a real SUV, not like compact SUV. SUV almost like a maybe Fortuner size SUVs. So that has, that sale is quite booming up. People are going for the top-loaded heavy features version, and a lot of jazz, LED lights in the door, trims. But in India, we don't have that kind of jazz. Also because of the cost competency of manufacturing, China, in the same price, you get Chinese top-load model. In India, you will get base model. So people are able to, Chinese manufacturers has able to manage cost competency so much that you get a top load version in the price of a base load, base version in India. And a lot of automation, the seats in a base model in Chinese automotive, the seats are automated. Just by clicking it, you can slide your seats, you can adjust the angle, you can adjust the heating and the cooling system on the door. Whereas that control you get in quite a middle segment or top segment in India. So a lot of cultural shocks once you go to the different country.
Right. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Yeah, so Yogesh, I have one question.
Yes, sorry.
Yeah, about do you have an incubator, in-house incubator, because you are so many creative minds. Mm-hmm. In Elixir, and I'm sure that there are designers who are not just working for clients, but every designer gets a new idea every now and then, which not everybody all the time, but there is a more frequent occurrence that an idea can perhaps be incubated. Because Tata Group is such a large group which might be which might want to tap these ideas. Does that happen in Elixir, or is there some other innovation? Every center has innovation, of course it has, but is there an incubator in your studio, or just curious,
sure. So yeah. That's a very nice question, because Tata Group itself is such a huge group. We usually there is a competition called Tata InnoVista. So that is competition held every year. Other lots of people from Tata Group, different businesses, participate in that for their own innovation, which they are doing in there, whether it's a Tata Steel, Tata Consultancy Services, Tata Automation Labs, lots of all Tata Group companies participate in that Tata InnoVista.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a platform, annual platform, which I myself is a jury on that Tata InnoVista. So we study and we validate, and we are a jury for those where all the entries get participated. So that is one innovation platform as a Tata Group which we have.
Mm-hmm.
The second is in Tata Elixir, we have a innovation lab.
Okay.
So as you said, there are lots of designers coming up with new features, and so we test it, we prototype it.
Okay.
And few ideas, lots of, we take an IP for that, and
okay,
we sell it to the companies.
Oh, you do that as
we do that as a process. So we design, wow, we prototype it, and then we own the IP, and then we sell it.
Okay.
And this is very good in the healthcare. We have a lot of patents in healthcare segment where the precision and automation is a key. So like insulin syringes or the injections, which are very critical with respect to the amount it will get. The healthcare has got a crazy standards, and the you need to conform to the various standards for that.
Okay.
So we do have few patents in that too. Yeah. So very. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. Very interesting.
Akshit is having a question. Please, Akshit, turn on your video, Akshit, please.
Sir, I wanted to ask, as like your department has many sub departments, like there is an engineering unit, there must be a materials expert. So does this make design process lengthy, and makes work more like like aapne unko diya and unse like validation ke liye wait karna and everything. So does that make the whole design process more lengthy and more time consuming?
Not really, actually, because if you see from the project side or from the client side, it becomes much more easier for them to manage a single point agency rather than multiple agencies. So if we are designing and somebody else is developing a technology, for the client it becomes quite a trouble because they need to handle two agencies. So from client side, it becomes very easy. Second thing, it doesn't become lengthy because it's all about project management. So once you actually, as being a corporate kind of a design center, there are lots of systems and technologies are well in place. So there is a business development department, there is a project planning thing. So there are project managers who are going to handle the project. There are lead designers. There are actual designers who are going to work on that. So because of this layered approach, the whole process becomes quite compact. There is a dedicated team to handle each and every part of the project. So business development will take care of the business side of it and client dialing. Lead designer will handle the project management. The actual work designer has to do is to just work on the design. So for the designers, it becomes very easy that they don't have to handle the much of the hassle of dealing with clients and project, handling the projects and the finances and the resources. So though it's a, for the project manager, it becomes quite a tussle because I need to handle the engineering side, I need to handle technology, business, finances, client. But for a designer, it becomes very easy because he needs to just focus on that work. So it doesn't become lengthy, it just becomes a little complicated to handle for one person, but that's a part of project management and you grow with that.
I have one more question. So
yeah.
After you have designed a product for a client, so while client is putting it in the market and doing all the marketing strategies, do the designer plays a role in it while he's doing the marketing strategy to guide him, because he knows the product better than the client at that point?
Depends on the product, actually. So imagine that you are dealing with the Symphony air coolers, which they are making coolers since donkey years. So if you are a new designer and if you are dealing with Symphony coolers, it's a hand in hand process because they know the manufacturing technology in and out. And as a designer, you might have some new innovative idea, which they are definitely, people are ready to accept it. But sometimes as they know the product better, there might be a case that they can tell you better about the product and the technology and the manufacturing than you. Whereas if it's a completely new product, which is not at all there in the market, you might be better positioned to guide the client.
So you do work with like existing your client's team also?
Yeah.
Client's team also plays a vital role in your design process.
True. Because you can't completely ignore the client, because they are, some clients are quite veteran in the industry. They are working since long time. And you might, so I may not be working on air coolers since my ages. client is working in cooler since ages, so definitely they have a more knowledge base. But at the same time, you can't ignore the designer's capability to think out of the box. There might be something which client may not have thought in the last 30 years. So there might be chances that you might come up with something completely new and which client will accept. So both goes very complementary with each other. And we do work with clients, whether they are novice or they are veteran in the industry. Both are important, and both we must respect whatever they have.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
As a designer, we should not always say that we are going to change the world. There are other people also who are going to play the part in that.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks.
Yeah. Does anybody have a question, or should I consider that all questions have been asked?
So just a small one.
Yes.
I wanted to like a piece of advice from Yogesh sir for young designers to like we should have before we like get into the market or into the
field. Oh my god. No, that's
like what would you say to yourself when you were like 22 or 21?
I mean it's just my personal opinion that I would say that you need to be a bit open-minded to the things, first thing, which as a designer, which has become very crucial because as you grow in the industry, because what will happen is an engineer may not have to be always dealing with so many stakeholders, whereas designer becomes very important because you need to deal with so many stakeholders. So being open-minded becomes even more crucial. So that is one piece I feel that you have to be open-minded. Second thing, you have to be always curious and inquisitive about the things. You should not stop asking questions, and you should not refrain yourself by challenging the norms. You can always say that why it has to be like this and why it cannot be like this. So you can always be curious about it. At the same time, you should be respecting what somebody has already done. Third thing, which I always realize when I'm in industry, when I'm dealing with business, technologies, engineers, you need to be a good listener. You need to be a very good listener because everyone is going to talk to you, right from users to the company owners. And even though you may not understand something from the aerospace technology, but if you are a good listener, you will definitely make some meaning out of it. So if somebody is talking about NASA or ISRO or some other rocket sciences, doesn't matter if not, it's not your field. You can always pay attention and you can be a good listener, and I'm sure you will get something out of it. And that's one more thing which I feel that you need to have it. And the fourth thing, I feel that you need to be good if you are hands-on. If you like to sketch, if you like to make models, if you like to play with materials, if you like to spend your weekend in the workshops, if you like to do some carpentry work out of the waste material from your furniture, it's amazing thing. So if you are hands-on, nothing like it. I think, yeah, that's all I can think of me right now.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Nice.
Yeah, somebody wants to ask a question, I think. Rohit Vadwani, please ask. Please ask, Rohit.
Yes, sir. So just a very small question. You spoke about how you collect matchboxes. I just wanted to know how many matchboxes have you collected so far? I'm just curious.
Yeah, I have more than around 20,000 matchboxes.
Whoa.
Yeah. Many of them are in the form of labels, because label collection of a matchbox, which is there on the top of the matchbox. So many of them are just labels, and some of them are full matchboxes. So, and when I collect it, I kept it in album. So I remove the inside tray and I flatten the matchbox and I keep it in the folder. So that's how I reduce the space. So it's a good
space. Have you ever redesigned the matchbox?
I haven't redesigned the matchbox. It's a good question. I tried some few times. I couldn't get better than what it is existing right now. Actually, because matchbox as an object, if you see as a designer, it has been designed almost 170 year back. The matchbox format which you see today, an outer sleeve and an inside tray, it has been designed 170 years back. So it's a classic piece of design. If you take from sustainability point of view, if you take the compact mesh, if you take the aesthetic value of it, if you take the nature, the way matchbox has been designed, which is very changeable with respect to the time. So it's a classic design object, and I never could crack it more beautiful than that.
But there's always, you know, a space for innovation in it.
Yeah, I'm still trying it.
Like every product can get better with time.
Perfect, you're on the mark. I completely agree. I just couldn't get it. But it's a good exercise. Every designer should try. Those who are attending this, just try on a weekend. Just try redesigning the matchbox. It's a fantastic exercise.
Okay, sir, can we DM you the design if we get onto something?
Oh, why not? Sure, I would love to.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Yes, that was lovely. Shobhik, is there anything to say? Anybody else has anything to say? This session went on very long and very intriguing, very interesting. One thought leading to another, and a lot of queries got answered today from the real world, Yogesh. So, So we are very thankful to you that you spared your time and shared this wonderful insights into the practical world of design. And I'm sure that all our viewers, all of us, have benefited from it, and we are inspired, to work and with the right mindset. Okay. Thanks. So I would like to, thank you again, and.
Quite happy that people were also very inquisitive, and a lot of students asked questions, so I also felt very nice. It was not at all boring session. I really enjoyed. Yes. And I, rather than mentor, I felt like I'm just your fellow designer, so I just share whatever I feel that.
Okay, great, lovely then. Okay, so I think with this we can call it a day, and
sure.
Have a nice weekend and happy Dasara for tomorrow.
Yes,
all
to you.
All of you. Yeah, you. Yes. Happy Dasara.
Happy Dasara to everyone, and thanks for inviting me to share my insights.
Yes. Okay. Bye.
Thank you, people. Bye bye. Thanks,
Ari.
Thank
you so much, Yogesh.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.